Let me read this tweet here. This is from someone who works at a venture capital firm in Silicon Valley. And Sheldon, here we go. Thanks for putting this up. Today, I met a company where the founder literally made me describe an app in text, and 20 minutes later, the entire app, back end and front end, was made and fully functional. Feels like the industrial revolution of software engineering. Okay, Christina, start us off on this. Will we look back on the era of massive teams of coders building an app, much like the way we look at the pre-industrial era today?
Well, I think when you frame it like that, people get a bit scared. They get sort of resistant to that whole model because they think this is going to come in and take away jobs or replace people. But actually, when I look at this, I think about my washing machine. So I have a washing machine that washes clothes so much better, faster than I could by hand. And I'm not mad at it. I'm not worried that it's going to take away anything from my productivity. In fact, it allows me to do many other more enjoyable, more creative, more important work.
And But you know why? Because we understand what a washing machine is, and we understand there are jobs in the creation of that machine. We don't know that about this.
We're figuring it out. And I think there's lots of choices. And there will be places where this will replace human labor. This will replace certain software engineers in certain tasks, for sure. But there's also so much opportunity. And I think if we over-focus on the loss or the replacement, we're going to miss the opportunity to find that complementarity, that co-intelligence, as Ethan Mollett calls it, where we can have an assistant that helps us do more, better, faster.
But and you have to look at it from the concept of, you know, if we go back to the era of the coder, where like the apps that were being created just by those coders building it up overnight were not the things that were solving breast cancer, and they weren't the things that were solving some of the more harder problems that society has. So I look at that at the natural evolution of a whole professional discipline where they started out, you got people interested in coding, and that became something, it became ubiquitous. And now the people that got really interested, they went into software engineering, and you could see the building of the skill set. And so right now, a lot of the coders that I talk to, they don't want to do that app at the front end. Like, they don't want to do that. They want to do the meatier problems, and they're evolving. So this is about the natural evolution, I think, of that industry. It had its time when the coding side blew up in terms of what the app is happening. And now I think we see that part of the productivity as essentially being solved. And we're trying to focus that mind that thinks in that logical way to some of the harder problems. And that's where you go from being a coder to being a software engineer to being an AI scientist. And you start to see that evolution of people. So for me, it's a natural evolution of skills.
Is coding no longer the sexy profession it once was?
Well, I mean, certainly this is, your example is not a trivial point. And you know, Christina and I were trained very similarly, and we both recite from the gospel of economics on this, which is everybody starts with talking about agriculture and reminding everyone that, remember, over 50% of us worked in agriculture. Today, less than 2% of us work in agriculture, and yet most people want a job, so they'll have one. And you know, aren't we glad that we don't all still work in agriculture? There's so many other things. Like, in other words, nothing wrong with agriculture, but many other things to do. Hmm. My concern, and I sort of, you know, up until I would say a year ago, would recite the same perspective that Christina shared and Krista, is that the reason that VC tweeted that thing is because it shocked him or her. And the reason it's shocking is because it's happening so fast. Mm-hmm. And all the times when we've gone through this before, the technological development has A, taken a longer time, and B, be narrowly focused in particular areas. This thing, that automated the software generation is a foundational model that can write software, can also make slides, can produce the script for the show, that can prepare all of the interview notes to help you prep for today's session. In other words, it can do all those things. And you open the show by talking about a $2 billion investment by the Canadian government. Mm-hmm. The company that did that raised $1 billion from Microsoft in 2019, another $2 billion in 2021, another $10 billion in 2023. Okay, they're a tiny company, originally not-for-profit company. So in other words, $13 billion to one company. And we're having this show because the Canadian government at a national level is putting in $2 billion. Okay? Another company similar of a similar type, only founded 3 years ago, Anthropic, just closed $4 billion, $1.5 billion in 2021 when they started, and another $2.75 billion from Amazon investment last year in 2023. So $4 billion for one startup company that's doing this, a foundational capability to write software, to write scripts, to read essays, all the stuff.
So if we look at the numbers, this does not look like a pawn that we can play in.
It just, all I just want to raise the possibility that the normal script that people like Christina and I recite in settings like this, where don't worry, we've had innovation before, we've been through all this before, I'm not sure if this falls in the same category because of how fast and how broad it's moving.
Okay, like, you want to take that on?
Well, it is fast. And so if you wanted us to have a friendly argument, we're probably in violent agreement on most of these things.
Only if you want to.
I do agree with Ajay that the speed is concerning, that it's hard to adapt, and it's hard to adapt to such, you know, big changes really quickly. This is a call for focusing on this and bringing our creative juices to bear and having all these conversations. But I don't think panic serves. I'm going to take a page out of Taylor Swift's book and say, you need to calm down. That if we don't sort of take a breath and you know, bring all these concerns out, of course, but if we just, you know, tumble forward into a frenzy, I don't know that we're going to solve these big problems.
Though
I'm not sure that taking a breath with the rapid pace of what the rest of the world is doing is actually the approach Canada should take. I actually think that this is a race that's happening globally, and we are getting left behind in terms of the speed in which other governments are actually allocating resources into this area. So when I look at the ability to take a breath, I'm naturally an optimistic person. I tend not to be one that cries wolf or gets scared about those kinds of things. But right now I'm worried for the future of Canada. I'm worried for my children. I'm worried for what's happening because we're falling behind.
What are you worried about in terms of
I'm worried
kids?
About the fact that we're not actually enabling the industry in the way that the rest of the world is, knowing that AI is coming and it's foundational in terms of what needs to happen. And so it's $2 billion. Sure, it's great for Canada. It's not great comparatively in terms of where we want to be, is my personal take on this.
And I can imagine a lot of people watching this right now are listening to it are panicking because A, they don't understand it, and B, they are sure that with all of the talk around this and the inevitability of it, that their jobs are going to disappear because of it. Now tell them why they shouldn't panic about that.
Well, historically, as Ajay said, and as our training and you know, we've been studying technological change for a minute, and we have always figured it out. I do agree with Krista that we can't just sit back on, you know, we can't rest on our heels here and watch this all unfold. We do need to lean forward and to really figure out what the jobs of the future are. I think a big challenge is going to be in how we train people. So I'm an educator, and AI came into my classroom really quickly. And many people decided that the approach to that was to put the brakes on and say no. And I think a more productive approach, with the one I tried to take, is to actually require my students to play around with ChatGPT, to try to get familiar with the technology. You said we get to use our washing machines because we understand them. Well, if we approach the technology and work with it, that understanding will start to unfold, and we can start to get better, faster, I hope, at training people to work with the technology and, you know, find the new jobs that they need to fill.
Wait a second. First of all, I'm not convinced that panic is a bad thing. Okay, so in other words, it's being described here as if panic would be a bad thing. I think a bad thing would be to people to watch this on their television and then just flick the channel and go watch something else and say, oh, well, you know. In other words, in my view, this is moving sufficiently fast. It's going to affect everybody at some level. There should be panic. But panic can be productive. Like, in other words, you know, what's the flip side of panic? It could be lethargy is not the right word, but
complacency.
Complacency. Okay, so complacency, if you think of complacency as the flip side of the coin to panic, if I had to pick one of those right now for Canada,
go for panic.
I would go for panic.
Yes. Absolutely.
Okay, and channel the panic into a productive way.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is made possible through generous philanthropic contributions from viewers like you. Thank you for supporting TVO's journalism.